We go over these attitudes each week and try to find something from God's Word that we can apply to our lives. And tonight we're on the attitude of faith. I'll read again for sake of review, Matthew chapter 5 and verse 10, where Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And then that text underneath that verse says, "I trust in the power of Jesus Christ to face hardships and trials." I'm not trying to get anybody to say that they experienced the same thing, but I think most everybody in this room could say that if you got saved a little bit later on in life, or maybe if you got saved earlier in life and you received Christ as Savior as a elementary school, young teenager, something like that, and then drifted away. That's a subtle way of saying it. Drifted away from the Lord, ran away from the Lord, rebelled against the Lord. But I would say this, I didn't get saved until I was 28 years old. I just turned 28 in 1984. And when I think of this idea, this Bible principle, really, of faith, this reality of faith, that I had faith. And I had some type of level or measure of faith in God. I mean, and it was to the degree where I believed in God. And that was the extent of it. And then anything beyond that was just what I believed personally about God.
Right.
That really didn't have anything to do with what the Bible taught about God. And I noticed when I was living in that kind of a mindset, that my opinions about God were always, or most of the time, were always in my favor. You know what I mean? So I never looked at God as like a holy God. And I'm not saying I would have denied that he is, or he was when I was at that age or that time in my life before I knew Christ as Savior. I never looked at God as a just God. You know, he's going to balance the scales. I never looked at God as a disciplinary God. I never looked at God as some kind of a God that is going to, that I'm going to reap what I sow. I just looked at God like, don't mess with him, don't disrespect him, and you'll be maybe okay.
Yeah.
And if you don't do that much bad, and you do a little bit of good, then when you die, you'll probably go to heaven. Well, I learned later on in life, and I'm still learning, that most of that was wrong. Now, I did believe that there was a God, that there was a loving God, because that was to my favor. I did believe that there was a God that may have been a patient God, because I was an example of that. Mercy, if you said, "Hey, God's merciful," I'd have bought into that too. And it was true. It would have been true. But we don't. If we're not careful, we'll take the attributes of God that are our favor and just try to live by them and live any way we want to. And that would be a heretical faith. That would be an imbalanced faith. See, we got to take God as we learn him out of the Word of God. And when we learn how God is in the Bible, he's all of those things. He's not just some of those things. And so when I get saved, when I put my faith, and by the way, that God gave me, we describe that as saving faith, my faith and trust in Christ and his finished work on the cross for my sins, asking to forgive me, inviting to come into my life, receive him as my Savior, that's what God did for me, and that's my response to what God did for me. I'm born again according to what the Word of God says. I'm saved. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be what? Shall be saved. And so that's a real thing. That's a reality. That's not some kind of religious thing. That's not kind of some kind of a come forward in a church thing. Boy, it may happen that way, but that's not just some religious act or some ritual thing that went on. There really should be in your life, in my life, if I name the name of Christ and I said that was a reality in my life at one time, there really should begin to be and continue to be some kind of manifested change in my life. Something should change. Well, a lot should change, but what should really change is me. Now, I would say that before I say anything else. It's not going to change overnight, but it's going to change overnight, 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 overnight. It should. And I participate in that. We participate in that. God just doesn't zap us into subjection. "Rick, you believe that I can do this?" "Yeah, boom, and I did it." Now, that's the beginning of it. Our faith, our belief that God can do this. And we're going to see that in a couple of minutes out of an example in the Word of God. But when we see that in the Word of God, my question is this. Do I really, not just do I believe what I'm reading, but does it change the way that I live? And fellas, listen, I've been guilty of what I'm talking about. We can believe what we're reading, but if it doesn't change the way that we live, we're really just stacking up judgment upon ourselves. Because we're going to be accountable for what we know.
Right.
And what we've learned. Then I'm not saying that as a scare tactic. That's just real. That's just real. God, by His grace, gets His word to us so we can experience what Jesus promised to us, an abundant life. Not just to believe a bunch of stuff about the Bible and not experience any life change. Because I think there's not a man in this room. I know I'm not the only guy in here who needs life change.
I do too.
I need it.
There's two of them.
I need it. I mean, I didn't get saved. I was 28 years old, and I wasn't doing life real well by that time. I wasn't getting any better at it. Matter of fact, I was getting worse at it. But God's real good at it. God says, I want to save you. I want to forgive you. I want to help you. I want to grow you. And I want you to experience your life, not in a perfect way, because there ain't no such thing as that until you get to heaven, but I want you to experience your life real practically, consistently, the way that I really intend for you to experience it. And we hear that, and we see that in so many examples in the Word of God. But listen, is it happening? Is it happening? And I'm not talking about it. Every single day is just so awesome, man. It's just a cakewalk. It's not a cakewalk. It wasn't a cakewalk for Peter, the Apostle Paul, for Moses, for David, for Samuel. You can go down the line. It wasn't a cakewalk for any of them either. But I'll tell you what, it was better than the walk they were walking prior to knowing God. And so it's not just, getting it up in here. It's getting it in here and it flows out of my life. What is the Christian life? It's allowing God to live His life in me and then through me. And allowing Him to work in my life, surrender to His will. Let me read you a couple paragraphs. We're going to be in Mark chapter 9 in a minute. Faith, we might say, is a strange thing. Most of us are better described as self-reliant than we are described as God-dependent. There's always the urge to solve our problems without the help of God. I'm probably not the only person that's ever done that. When we think that we are capable of solving them. Yes, there are many things that we can do on our own, and perhaps some of these things are not all that bad. But there are also many things we cannot do on our own, and when we try, they do indeed turn out bad. As I look back at the experience of faith in my life, I have learned a few things along the way, and I'm not the expert, by the way. Most of the important things that I've learned is that God wants me to keep Him all-inclusive in my life. In other words, He would have me to not only involve Him in the activities and decisions of my life, but allow Him to lead me in the activities and decisions of my life. The more dependent I become on Him, the better I am equipping myself for the challenges of life. Faith, by definition, listen, can be described as belief in or devotion to or trust in somebody or something, especially without logical proof. In other words, if you get a glimpse of the Christian life, if you want to look at it logically, it doesn't add up logically. You can't look at it and say, oh, I totally understand it, or there wouldn't be any faith at all. When you read the Word of God and you see that Jesus walked on the water, you don't go, well, I know how He did that. No, when you see Simon Peter step out of the boat and walk on the water at the same time, you didn't go, well, I know how He did that, so therefore I believe it. No, we don't know how it happened, and therefore we still believe it. That's faith, when it doesn't necessarily make logical sense. And so when we see this, listen, there may be many times in the Christian life that our faith will be challenged. Certain decisions and matters of trust are made when we do not always have logical proof for them turning out to our liking. We must understand that all decisions in this life should be left to the leadership of God as it pertains to the will of God. There are many examples in the Word of God that speak of people making decisions that did not always make logical sense. Listen to a few of them. Abraham left the comforts of home and familiar surroundings, literally not knowing where he was going. I did that a couple of nights on the weekend, but the bottom line is he did it by faith. I did it by not even sight. Moses led the children of Israel for 40 years in the wilderness with the promise of a promised land, but not knowing when he would arrive there, and came to find that he would not arrive there himself. Simon Peter was invited to step out of a boat and walk on water. Thomas was shocked by the news of the resurrection, and John the Baptist was challenging the biggest trial of his life as to whether or not Jesus was really who he said he was. It has been wisely said that a faith that has not been challenged may not be faith at all.
Amen.
No one wants it challenged, and no one asks that it might be challenged, but walk the journey of faith for a period of time, and your faith, if it is authentic, will be challenged.
Yes, it will.
There's no doubt about that. Mark it down. And I'm not setting you up for failure or setting you up for some kind of scary thing, but I do know this. I've seen it over and over and over again, and it's awesome to me. And I thought about this not too long ago. It's awesome to me, and I've watched it over the years, and I experienced it in my personal life. And I'm not saying it's cookie cutter across the board like I'm fixing to describe, but I've noticed that when people, especially that people have come from some of the junk that I came from and similarities of it that we don't even know need to go into any detail about.
And worse.
That what happens sometimes, oftentimes, is they are enlightened to God's word, their opportunity to ask Jesus Christ to come into their life, and they ask him to forgive their sins, they come into his life, and they get saved. They're born again, like we just described a couple minutes ago. And it's absolutely amazing to me, every time I see it, that God just begins the process of just dumping on them. Just showing himself so amazingly personal and real and miraculously strong and provisional and protective. And it's so obvious because he's just giving them that assurance, and it happens all the time. I see it all the time. That assurance that just, man, God is doing this, God is doing that. And I've seen people get saved. They're saved for a month or two, and almost every time you see them, bro, Rick, you ain't believe what just happened. You ain't believe what God did. You ain't believe what God did. God does that all the time. But I will tell you this, and I'm not trying to set you up to scare you, but I will tell you this, sooner or later, that storm's coming too. That storm's coming too. What is God doing? God is not setting you and I up. God is preparing us and building us up for when the storm does come. I rarely have I ever seen, and I can't really think of a time where somebody just got saved and then the bottom dropped out. The bottom drops out usually before we get saved, which causes us to think about getting saved and helps us to get saved. And then all of a sudden, God's like, whoa, he's just all over our life. What do? We drop the bottom out now. We do it. We go, man, I got enough God, man. I'm doing great, man. I got a license. You know what I mean? I got a legal tag. You know what I'm saying? All these things that, you know, we think, I got rent, man. I got a place to stay. I got, man, my girlfriend just answered the phone. What's up? God's working in my life. And then all of a sudden we get a little bit comfortable. We get comfortable. And we think this, you know, this, and I'm not being a rebel, but this God thing, man, I got the hookup. And God's saying, okay. Well, let's see how you all got, boy. And he'll either allow a trial or send one. You say, well, that's cruel. That's not cruel. That's not cruel. Because like I said in the beginning of this, faith that's not been tested ain't no faith at all. You really know, you won't know much about a man when he's on the mountain, but you'll learn a lot about him in the valley. You'll learn a lot about him. And I tell you what, some of the, I don't want any more of them. And I'm sure I'll probably get some. Hopefully, I'm not asking for any. I know that. But I'll tell you what. There has never been times that I've been closer to God when everything was going totally wrong than it was when everything was going totally right. We're like, man, this is just cool. Coasting, praising God, everything's great. And you're not that you don't sense the need for God, but it's not as dependent like that as you are when the bottom drops out. God says, I'm trying to draw you closer to me so you depend more on me so you can know that, listen, I'm all you need. I've noticed, listen, that there's rarely excited when our faith is tested until the test is over and we have passed the test. You know, in other words, when it's going on, ain't no excitement about that. But when it's over, and everybody in this room, you've been tested. You've had storms. And maybe you're going through one, but I guarantee you've been through some that are over. And I got a word for that. Praise God.
Yes.
It's over. It's over. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. And so we don't know how long it's always going to last. The fallout is sometimes horrific. And then all of a sudden, God begins to help us to put things back together. You can look back at that and say, look what God did.
Yes.
Look what God did. And I don't think that, you know, all of us have situations that are different. The circumstances are different. The severity of the trial certainly may be different in a lot of different lives personally here, but I don't think there's a man in here. I know there's not a man in here that ain't gone through some stuff that you wish you wouldn't have had to go through.
Yes, sir.
You know, I remember 10 years ago, and I'll share a little bit of this in here, and I'll be brief, but I remember 10, 12 years ago, I donated blood. Just donated blood because it was the right thing to do, and I was overseeing an event at our church. I donated blood, and I got a letter from a blood bank about 3 or 4 weeks later saying I had hepatitis C. Donating blood, been clean for 18 years. And then I'm just looking at, you know, my wife's telling me, she's reading the letter to me over the phone. I'm up here on the church property, and I thought, you know, wow, here we, you know, I didn't know I had it. I didn't feel like I had it. I was never diagnosed because I never had a reason to try to find out or any other thing like that. So I donated blood, and that's how I got found out. And I'll tell you what, man, as soon as I heard that, I'm like, That's no surprise to me. You know what I mean? That's like, that's no surprise to me. And I wasn't like jumping. I mean, I wouldn't do backflips. Trust me. I was like wondering, how's this going to turn out? What's going to go on with this? But I'll tell you this. That was about 12 years ago. That was about 12 years ago. And I looked at it, and I came away from it. And by the way, I ain't no super spiritual guy. I wrestled with it. I woke up with it every single day knowing about it. And I thought about it almost every single day. Didn't fret, didn't worry, didn't lose sleep and everything like that. But I do know this, that if God would have never showed me that I had it, I might have died from it. You know what I mean? So I mean, I look back at it, I'm like, God, it was me that did it, and then you that exposed it, so I could get help with it.
Yeah.
So I could get help with it. And that whole journey for almost 12 years was back and forth and up and down and wondering and not doing anything and doing something. It was a journey. But God, listen, it wasn't the worst trial of my life, but I could have made it that way.
Amen.
I could have made it that way. I could have rebelled against my own rebellion. Because my rebellion is what got it. That's how I got it. I could have rebelled against what I did. And then blamed it on God and said he did it. No, that ain't how it works. I'm not trying to be spiritual at all. It made me a better man. I'm reading the Bible all the time and God's speaking to my heart about it. I read about Paul's thorn in the flesh and I surrendered to that. I said, God, that's my thorn in the flesh. That's it. That's what I'm cool with it. And if I live with it, I'll live with it. If I die with it, I'll die with it. And I just like, man, but here's today. It's like, what are you going to do? Well, I'm already cured, but I ain't talking about 5 years ago. 5 years ago, what are you going to do? I'm going to get up and I'm going to live.
Yeah.
What the heck, man? I want to live.
Amen.
I'm not going to just die till I die. You know what I mean? Die to the circumstances. just embrace it. The trial is what it is. And what are we looking for when we're going through it? I don't know what you're looking for, but I used to look for a way out. Who wouldn't? But now I'm looking for a way through. Who shouldn't?
Amen.
God, you're trying to teach me something. If you get me out of everything, what am I going to learn? That God's the getter-outer. You know, like a Monopoly game. You know, get out of jail free and, you know, collect $200 or something, something. Don't pass go, whatever it was. No, it's like God said, I want to take you through this. I don't always just want to pull you out of it. Look at the children of Israel. He took them through. He didn't pull them out. He took them through. A lot of them didn't make it because they rebelled against it. They rebelled against the trial. And so when we think about that, I've noticed that we're really excited about it, but we would say, practically speaking, we pass the test when we're more relying on God to come through than we are relying on ourselves to survive it.
Amen.
In other words, we're dependent on God to help us through it than we are depending on ourselves to survive it. If you survive the storm on your own, that takes a lot out of you, man.
Yeah, it does.
It takes a lot out of you. And you didn't really learn, I'm not being, you know, in no disrespect, you didn't really learn much but about yourself that you shouldn't have tried to survive it on your own. You know? I mean, we're just men on our best day. And so regardless of the outcome, when we're tested, we have passed the test when we trust wholeheartedly on God, not ourselves, and it's then that our faith will be increased. Mark chapter 9, I'll read the story real quick and then make some application. Mark chapter 9 and verse 14, the Bible says, and when he came to his disciples, that's Jesus, he saw a great multitude about them and the scribes questioning them. Straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed and running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, why question ye them? They're questioning the disciples. And one of the multitude answered, said, Master, I brought unto you my son, which hath a dumb spirit. And wherever it taketh him, it tears him, and he foams, and gnashes at his teeth, and pineth away, or he goes into convulsions. And I spoke to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. And he answered him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell down on the ground, and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, how long ago is it since this came unto him? And he said, of a child. Oftentimes you cast him into the fire and into the waters, to destroy him. That's a pretty bad deal. If you got a son and that was going on, that'd be a bad deal. This guy's in a bad way. And then he says to Jesus, he says, and if thou can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said unto him, if thou can believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out with tears, Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. The first thing that we see here is the confusion. It's interesting when you look at the Bible in the context in which it's written, in the story which is written, and you find out other things about what's going on. It's interesting when you see this particular story, why I would describe it as the confusion. Because in verses 14 through 18, he comes up, Jesus comes up, and the disciples, there's this, not this argument, there could have been an argument, but there could have been a debate, but there was something going on. There was some verbal exchange going on between the scribes and the disciples. And what had happened is this man brought his son to the disciples to heal him or to deliver him from this demonic possession, and they couldn't do it. Well, it's interesting when we think about it and we see what the Word of God says about it, that in Mark chapter 3, Jesus did give them the power to do that which they could not do that day.
That's right. Yep.
And so that's why I would say it's confusion on the father's part. It's certainly confusion if the kid has a sane thought. It's confusion on his fault, on his part, and it's also confusion on the disciples' part. They were told they could do something that they couldn't do. And it makes me to think that, listen, it's interesting in the walk. We're talking about faith. And when we read the Bible, and I go back to what I said earlier, when we go back to the Bible, we see, well, Jesus said, I've come that you have life and you have it more abundantly. We go, yeah, that's really awesome. That means content and satisfied and full. But I don't have it. I don't have it. It ain't happening in my life. And I've heard about deliverance. He can deliver, and he delivers from the bondage of sin. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 14, sin shall no longer have dominion over you. And it's talking to the saved man, but I'm a saved man, and sin's got dominion over me. And I'm still in my stuff. That's a whole lot of what was going on just now. These guys are thinking, I can do something. And I tell you, it breaks my heart, and it breaks my heart when it happens to me. That there's so many promises in the Word of God on the way that I can live and the experience of the Christian life that sometimes I'm not experiencing, and I'm going like, why? Why? Well, I tell you what, it ain't no fault of the Bible, and it ain't no fault of God.
Amen.
And I'm not saying it's because, man, I'm not clenching my fist and gritting my teeth enough and believing. Maybe that's where it is. Well, I tell you what, maybe I ought to get in the mirror and find out if there's something in my life that's keeping that from happening.
Amen.
Maybe it's just my will. Maybe there's a battle for my will. I don't want to give up something. I don't want to stop something. I don't want to start something. Maybe I just want all of God and God's not getting any of me.
Yeah.
Maybe I just want to believe the good things about God like we talked about at the beginning, what he can do and not what I should do.
All
right. Maybe it's not. Listen, fellas, you don't need a microscope to get in your own life to find out that part of it's jacked up sometimes.
Yeah.
And it might be hindering the work of God in your life and the power of God in your life and my life because of me. And I ain't talking about sinless perfection. Don't think that. Listen, it appears the disciples were not able to do something that they had been given the authority to do. And here we have the confusion of the Father, who desperately needed a cure, and also the confusion of the disciples, who previously had been given the power to meet the need presented to them. In Mark chapter 3, as I mentioned, in verse 15, and to have power to heal sickness and to cast out devils. That's what he gave them to do. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 33, for God is not the author of what? Confusion. The Bible says God's not a part of that, but of peace, as in all the churches of the saints. That word confusion, it's an interesting word. It means instability. God's not the author of that. And so in other words, when things are going on that ain't going on, there's that uneasiness, and I guarantee you this was one of them, God wasn't the reason for it. God wasn't causing that. It can be frustrating and defeating for any follower of Christ to not experience what God has told them that they can experience and even given them the power to experience. By faith, we believe what we read in the Bible and perhaps never struggle with believing those things that we read. Then we're challenged with the difficulties of life when comparatively they may be dwarfed by what we see God doing in the Bible, and yet we still struggle to believe that God will come through for us. Have you ever, maybe I'm the only guy, but have you ever believed it'll happen for somebody else more than it'll happen for you?
Yeah.
Looked at somebody else's life and goes, man, God's just really doing a work in their life.
Yep.
And almost afraid to say, but it's not happening in mine. Is God different in that guy's life than he is in my life?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever?
Right.
I'm the Lord, I change not. See, the power that he has and he wants to unleash in somebody else's life, he wants to do the same thing in my life.
Yes, sir.
But it's conditional. If God's working in and through anybody's life, I'll tell you what primarily it is. It is faith and surrender. That's what it is, man. And I know we can add to that, but it primarily, generally speaking, it's faith and surrender.
Amen.
They're just allowing God to work in their life. And they're just putting down, they're throwing up the white flag and say, I can't do this. I can't do this. If you want to say it like, I can't do it anymore. I can't do it on my own. It takes a lot of years to get to that for some of us. You know, God didn't make everybody say concrete, but some of us, I guess he did. But you know, when you figure your way's not working all the time, and you figure when you do take a step of faith, and you start to believe God, and you start to surrender your will to God, and you do see God start to work in your life. But you know what we are? Most of us are in a hurry. We don't want to wait on God. Sometimes faith says, wait.
Yep. Again, wait.
We want it now, man. We want Jiffy Pop, God. We want it right now, man. God, do it now. Like that old poster that cat, some, give me patience and give it to me now. No, man, it doesn't work like that. Because we're not on God's timetable. Or he's not on mine, I'm on his. And he doesn't think about time. He's not worried about time. Listen, when we think about that confusion, it can be very concerning the very difficult challenge of addictive behavior. Listen, there are many scriptures in the Word of God that speak to our victory. Always remember, addiction may be big, but it's not bigger than God. Yes, we do need to do our part in the process of change, and we should do our part. But while doing our part, we must also take God at his word and ask him to strengthen our resolve and to believe him at all costs. And we've heard this verse. I'm guessing, and it might be a pretty accurate guess, that most, if not everybody in the room, has heard these two verses in John chapter 8 and verse 32, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The other one's in verse 36. It's been on that wall ever since anybody in this room has been coming in this room. If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Now, I don't know what you know about free. Yeah. But it's nothing to do with bondage. It ain't got nothing to do with chains. Nothing to do with, you know, addiction and dominion and everything like that. It's free. Free to do what? Not free to do whatever I want to do. Free to not have to do what I couldn't stop doing. It's not just this liberty that you say, oh man, God's a God of grace and God of love, and he's just going to let me do whatever I want. We already learned that the hard way. That's not the case. It's the freedom not to be bound by the things that I was bound by. It's to walk in the liberty that God has set me free from and to. And so we think about this, but we look around, and you see in a lot of other people, what's wrong with us? We're going to get to that in a second. The scribes' attitude, the humiliation of the disciples, which we can be sure did not help their confusion. Just because God hadn't come through doesn't mean, listen, that he won't. I don't know about you, but I know, and not in maybe in a literal sense, but I think practically speaking, God waited on me for a while.
Amen.
I don't know how long he waited on you, but how long we wait on him?
Oh, a couple days.
Yeah. And if it ain't coming, if it ain't happening, man, I prayed 3 times for this thing. Really? And I'm convicted when I say that. I led a guy to the Lord one time and met another guy that heard that guy got saved, and he came up to me and he said, I heard old so-and-so got saved. I said, yeah, man, it was great. You know, I was there, blah, 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 gave me little details about it. He said, I've been praying for him for 8 years. Yeah. I felt like a worm, man. I felt like a worm. I was like, are you kidding me, man? You pray for him for 8 years, I talked to him for 25 minutes. And we pray for something for a week or 2 weeks, and we don't see nothing happening. Let me tell you this. When you're praying, something's happening.
That's right.
Why do we got to see it all the time? Because, listen, if we saw it, it wouldn't be faith.
Right.
Here's what I see. God's going to do something.
Right.
He's going to do something. And whatever he does is going to be good for me. Well, I've been praying to hit the lotto a bunch of times. Well, it'll probably kill you. That's probably why you ain't hit it. You know what I mean? All right? So it won't be good for you. Listen, God's about answering according to his will.
Right.
Not according to mine. You know, I'm trying to make a habit of this. God, if it be your will, God, here's what I'm praying. And if it's not, it's not. Just let it go. God's going to get his way anyway. And so we think that first thing there, and then second after this, listen, the misunderstanding. That misunderstanding, now we turn to the misunderstanding of the Father. Here's what he says. He came earlier to the disciples of Christ and he was disappointed with the result of their efforts. Now he comes to Jesus hoping for a better outcome. His misunderstanding was not on what he was asking, but in the way that he asked. Listen to what he said. When we go back up there, where is it? His father said, how long did he go? And said, a child oftentimes lives in the fire. Verse 22, and oftentimes it has cast him into the fire, into the waters to destroy him. But if you can do anything, if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. If. I will tell you this, that ain't how to get a prayer answered. But in spite of that, he got an answer. Isn't that amazing? It's grace. But Jesus didn't answer until he corrected him and taught him, if you will, how to pray it. That's what he said. So he turned and said, if you can do anything, have compassion on us. When we come to God, we learn from this biblical example that it's not whether or not God can do something, it's whether or not he will do something. And so we think about that. God lacks no power and ability to do anything. We know that without faith it is impossible to please him, according to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 16. So listen. So then, we also know that this man would have been much better pleased the Lord when he said, I know that you can, and I pray that you will.
Amen.
And I'll tell you, and I'm not trying to teach you how to pray, but I'm taking something from the Word of God that we can apply to our prayer life by faith and believe it. And I'm not saying you will get everything that you get that you ask for because you're going to do it this way. But I would tell you this, that if I start going, if you can do this, God, I would like this happen. Or I'm praying, and I do this often. God, I know you can do this.
Yeah.
I know you can.
Amen.
I know you can do this. And I'm just praying that you will.
Yeah.
I'm just praying that you will. But be surrendered to whatever he does.
Yeah.
Don't get all bent out of shape if he doesn't. It seems like a kind of a mundane thing, and maybe a trivial thing to some of you, but I remember during a time when one of my dogs got lost. He was gone for 5 days, man, and it was a hunt, man. It was a massive hunt, and I was out every day after work till dark looking for this dog, not because he's so expensive, but the fact that I just loved my dog. And I was looking, and I was standing in the middle, because the last time somebody saw him was in the middle of the old airport. I was in the middle of that vacant lot. When you talk about vacant lot, it's square miles. Standing out there about to get dark, and I'm looking up to God, and I say, God, I know you know where that dog's at right now. I know you do. And if somebody who didn't know God, didn't know anything about God, thought I was just slap crazy. And I was talking just like I'm talking now. God, I know you know where he's at. And all I'm asking you to do is just show me. Where's he at? In Jesus' name, of course. And I'm like, come on, God. Just show me. We weren't like day four. We weren't on day four at that time. And God decided not to show me that day. Not to show me. I had almost surrendered, and this is the end of this. The next day, I get off work. I go back to the area where somebody said that they saw one. And I saw this guy, all these old airplane hangars over there in the old airport. The whole place is pretty much vacant. Now they're starting to build some houses to the left. But I go around there, and a guy said to me, and I'm just, he knew what I was, because they'd seen me almost every day. He gave me the code to the gate and everything like that, which was very nice of him and everything like that. And, you know, told me if they'd see me, they'd have my number and everything like that. So I go past it, and he waves me over, and he goes, hey, man. He goes, y'all think about something. He said, why don't you get his bowl? Go home, get his bowl, and just sit somewhere. And so I say, you know, that might not be a bad idea. So I leave, I go get his bowl. While I'm back there, my future, who's now my son-in-law, he said, you know what? He said, you know what, brother man? He said, and he used to hunt with dogs and everything like that up in Carolina. He said, you know what we used to do when we used to lose a dog? He said, we take something that belonged to us, a piece of clothes or something like that, and lay it with the bowl of food. And he said, and more times than not, that dog will be laying by that food and that jacket that belonged to the owner. And I said, man, that's a good idea. I'm going to try it. I'm trying anything. You know what I mean? And so I went home. I got a jacket. I got my bath towel. I was like, you don't smell nothing on that.
Who are you on that one?
Little rocket, buddy. And all over me, all right? Don't get a word picture there. So I got the bowl, and now we're on day five. And I'm like, you know, this is almost like, I got no more hope of this. This is it.
Hope
is there. And I think, because there are a bunch of coyotes over there, too. And so I rolled up there. I sat the towel out, sat the bowl out. I said, you know, I'm gonna take one more ride around here. And I took one ride around, and I just right out of the corner of my eye, I thought I saw something stick its head up. By this time, I'm thinking I'm having, like, what do they call it? Hallucinations or, you know, some
mirage,
you know? And I look back at him, and I see them two ears sticking up out of a ditch. And then I thought, man, he's dead. But at least I found him, you know what I mean? Like, good night. And sure enough, he looks up, and I'm like, no way, man. I backed up, wheezed up to him, and I was about from here to midget right there. And he caught a glimpse of me, but he didn't know who I was. He'd been out for 5 days. It was in the summertime, so he was in shock, as best I know. Had foam all spit all over his mouth and everything like that. He takes off. I'm about to shoot him, so I know this thing will happen, man. So he ran all the way. I'm gonna try to keep this brief. He runs all the way down that outside fence on 390, and I'm just riding right next to him. I said, "We'll ride as long as you want to ride." He got to the end of it, and I turn around. I started drifting closer, and he started riding all the way back up. And I could tell that he ain't gonna last. His paws were bloody. The palms of his feet were bloody. And I got up, and I just chunked some food. He ran all the way up to one of those slabs where a hangar used to be. And he's just sitting there, and it starts raining. And I got right here to Keith, and I just threw some food at him. And he starts nibbling on it. And I just threw some food a little bit closer to me. He started nibbling, I started throwing a little bit closer to me. And then he got a whiff of me and almost jumped, slapping the window. There's still marks on my truck today from when he tried to jump in there. Listen, man, you say, well, what was all that about? I don't know what you think it was about, but I think that this fool was standing in the middle of the airport telling God, I know you know where he's at. But God said to me, I know you're going to work a little harder. You're going to listen. Just keep on asking, keep on asking, keep on asking. And I did. And I'm not saying it all works out the same way, because we lost a dog about a month ago that got hit by a car. And he's gone. And God didn't answer that prayer. But that don't make him any better than God. He's still God. So it's a great misunderstanding. So what did Jesus say? He said, the Father says, if you can do anything, help us. Jesus takes the if and kind of throws it back to the dad. He said, it's not if I can help you. He said, it's if you can believe. Now I'll read you something from the Word of God. It's straight from the Bible. He said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him that believes. Now I'm going to say this. You're going to either believe that or not. He didn't say some things. He didn't say most things. He didn't say a few things. He said, all things are possible to him that believes.
Amen.
You say, well, how come it ain't happening? I think it's because it's outside of the sovereignty and the will of God. When it doesn't happen in my life or it doesn't happen in your life. But that doesn't mean that it's not possible with God. Because nothing is impossible with God. And as we think about this, one of the most powerful phrases in the Bible follows, if you can believe what Jesus said, all things are possible to him that believes. Is there anything any more profound and inclusive as this statement? All things we know means, obviously, all things. I got a question, and I'm not asking for an answer. What is my lack of faith keeping me from having or experiencing when God tells me that all things are possible to him who believes? And I ain't talking about name it and claim it. But what is my lack of faith keeping me from experiencing in my life because I just won't want to believe God? Now, say, Rick, I don't get where you're coming from with this. Like, you know, where am I going to get to where it actually clicks? You know, well, that's God's business. That ain't mine. I don't know where that's at. Because I used to think that too, man. If I just keep on, it's almost like you're trying to crank a motor or something like that. No, it's just straight up, God, I can't do this. I can't do this. I don't know about you. I don't know how many times I tried to quit dope and quit alcohol and everything like that till I came to the realization, God, guess what? I can't do this. You got to do it.
Yeah.
I just can't. I'm going to be like that. I really thought I'm going to be like this the rest of my life. I can't. And God says, thank you.
I can.
I can. But you're going to walk through it with me.
Amen.
And you're going to follow me in it. And there's going to be some time that you want to do that, but I can keep you from that. But you got to follow me. You got to keep on following me. And when you think you can't, and you trust that I can, follow me. And then you will. You will. And tell him, fellas, it doesn't, The Christian life shouldn't get harder and harder. It should get better and better. And I'm not using the word easy, but it should get better and better. Not just that, well, everything's great, all my bills are paid. Hallelujah for you. Okay? I'm just saying, but it's not like you're going to get to this arrival like, I got no problems anymore. Awesome. But you're probably going to wake up from that. Because that's a dream. It doesn't happen like that. Because every time you get rid of one problem, another one's coming down the road.
Amen.
You know, it's just part of life. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 27. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Let God ask that question to all of us. Luke chapter 18, verse 27. He said, the things which are impossible of men, listen, with men are possible with God. And then the admission. And here's where we are, and I'll bring this thing to a close. The admission. Straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Now, it didn't end there. Because if it ended there, it'd be like, man, he just got his faith right there, man. He just nailed it. He just grew, and he just became a mountain faith right there. No, he didn't say it like that. He didn't finish there. He said, Lord, I believe. Anybody know what he said after that?
Help
my unbelief. Fellas, I think this is where a lot of us live. And I'm not saying it's because we're terrible, lukewarm, sorry Christians. But there's part of us that do, and there's part of us that don't.
That's right.
There's the faith, and there's the doubt. There's the spiritual part, and there's the fleshly part. There's the supernatural part, and there's what we think is the reality part. You got to believe in Him, do they? But. I ain't being disrespectful. God said, leave your butt out of it. Forget it. Don't worry about that part. And when we think about it, it's very evident that the boy's father was conflicted. On the one hand, he has doubts about Jesus and his disciples as to whether or not it could help. On the other hand, he had a very serious issue concerning his son, and he needed to believe that they could meet the need. We might also experience the conflict of faith and doubt. Faith tells us that God can do anything, and our doubt might cause us to think that even if He can, perhaps He won't. That's a real life experience. The Father may not have been in the category that those that did believe Jesus could do what He said He could do, and then He did, and you see that in Matthew chapter 8 and Matthew chapter 15, but He did have enough faith perhaps to sustain Him and give Him the hope that He needed for that day and that time. What a great insight we have given here, because it gives us a biblical example, although a negative one, of unnecessary torment that can, listen, we can put ourselves through when we refuse to give in to God entirely and believe what He says with complete trust and acting upon it in complete faith. True faith, listen, that is undivided, is a very powerful thing, but a little doubt can squash it.
Wow.
Just let God have His way, man. You know, and fellas, I think sometimes, you know, I try to be as practical as I can, because I think that's the only way that we ought to be, and as transparent as I can, because I look at this and I'm going like, man, that's me. That's me. I'm not teaching this like, man, I hope all these guys get it like I get it. No, I hope we all get it together. But I get that. I get that. I'm trying to get to the place in my life, you know, constantly. Like, God, I just want to pray about something. I just want to leave it alone. And if you tell me to participate in it, if you tell me to do anything that involves the provision that I'm asking for, the protection I'm asking for, the wisdom, God, just show me and just help me to be obedient. Because God, by the way, God uses us sometimes to answer our own prayers, right?
For sure.
God, pray me, you know, God, I'm praying for a job. Does that mean I gotta get out of bed and go apply? You know what I mean? He uses us in the answers of our own prayers. You know? In other words, we say, God, here it is. And then God says, well, you just be available. Be available. And step up. Do the next right thing. But in the meantime, while God's doing whatever He's doing that we don't know what He's doing, we ought to be doing what we ought to be doing.
Amen.
You know, don't just go out to the far country again and wait for God to. Oh, he did it? Oh, God, I'm back. No. Man, there's things that we can do while God's doing whatever it is He's doing. Because don't get caught up in this easy believism and, you know, this name it, claim it, junk, that just because you're a God's just going to dump all kind of stuff on you. you know, that we got no business having in some cases, and we most of us don't need in other cases, that will make us more spoiled and independent than it will make us dependent. You know, it's a bunch of heretical, nightmare, garbage Christianity, so-called Christianity out there that says just because you're a Christian, you can get anything you want from God.
Right.
No, it's not true. It's not true. Some of the most spiritual, godly, recognized people in the Word of God didn't have anything. Did not have anything. The lady who came to see said, what did Jesus say about the one lady? She gave what she could. Less than everybody, but he made more of her.
Right.
Yep. Right.
Too much.
You know? He told as much. What God has said.
Amen.
That old song, labor not for wealth and fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's just believe God. Let's just believe God. Haven't we tried this long enough without, you know, I'm not talking about in a literal sense, you know. But whatever you believe in God for now, and we don't do this all the time before our share time, but I'm going to pray. And while I pray, whatever it is that you carried in here, and I ain't talking about, you know, your wallet or whatever, I'm just talking about your burden. Why not just give it to God?
Amen.
Just give it to him. Now, I don't know, the biggest man in here, shoulders ain't big enough to carry the burden that Satan wants to put on you, that God wants us to put on him.
That's right.
And just give it to him. Let him have it. And let him have his way. And let's just say, God, make me available. Just help me to be part of the solution if you call on me to. In the meantime, I just want to follow you. And I want to trust you. Let's go ahead and pray. Father God, what an amazing example of a man that struggled to believe and yet received what he was asking for. God, the rest of this story, although we didn't go through the whole thing, this boy was healed. He was delivered. And it wasn't because this man had mountain-moving faith. He said some. But he went to the right source. He went to the one, the only one, that could do the impossible. And it became possible. God, I know, beyond a shadow of a doubt, there's more than 50 guys in this room. We all got stuff. We all got burdens. We all got things going on in our life and around our life that God, if we could change them right now, we would. But we can't. God, I pray for everybody in this room, and especially myself, that we'll embrace that reality and that we'll just release it to you. If it's provision, God, we trust you to provide it. If it's financial provision, God, we're going to trust you to provide it. If it's shelter, we're going to trust you to provide it. God, if it's legal things, we're going to trust you to provide it. God, if it's family things, we're going to trust you to provide it. God, if it's just a burden relationally, we're going to trust you to heal it. And God, if it's us, rebelliously, we're going to trust you to help us to follow you and obey you.
Yes.
God, it's not going to be easy all the time. But it'll all the time be worth it. I pray for every man in this room. And God, my prayers are no more important than anybody else's. That God, whatever we're going through now, we're going to lay at your feet right now. We're going to walk out of here lighter. Because we believe that you can do anything. We know that you can take care of the burdens that are on the hearts of the men in this room. We know you can. And we pray that you will. We're giving it to you, God. In Jesus' name. Well, we're going to have our share time. What's said in the room stays in the room. If you want to share, you can share. If you want to share about something, the attitude we talked about tonight, the attitude of faith, God's doing something in your life, we want to hear about it. We're not trying to get somebody to share. We're certainly not going to compel you to do that. But if God's working in your life and you want to keep it down about 2 or 3 minutes and share it with your group, you're more than welcome to do that. Not here to talk back and forth to each other, to crosstalk or preach or fix each other. It's just about you in first person. And when we finish, we'll have a word of prayer and we'll be dismissed. So the floor is open for anybody that wants to share.